And find a seat. We'll be starting the meeting shortly. Welcome if you're new or visiting. If you need the toilets, you can go down the door to my right, your left, and just follow the signs. They're sort of directly behind the stage. We love to hear from God in this church. So if you feel God speaking to you during the service, come down and speak to Tom. And we will weigh that and think about when we can share it. I'll hand over to the worship team and we'll start. So Father, thank you for this morning. I pray that you would be with us as we worship you. Amen.
First of all, can I please separate Maricel and Ginny? There'll be nothing but trouble if those two sit together. So, Anilo and Chidima, welcome. It's great to see you. You look fabulous. We're going to sing a song that has a chorus in Nigerian. So my apologies for my probably awful accent and dreadful pronunciation, but it's Imela, which means thank you, Okaka Oyekurua, which means great and mighty, creator of the world, Ezemo, my king. Is that all right?
Excellent.
So we'll play it through. You can join in, do stand up. When I think of all your goodness and your faithfulness each day, I'm convinced it's not because I'm worthy to receive the kind of love that you
I could never sing your Slain sing for all that you've done for me. Above every other name.
always closer than we know, always more involved and in control. Lord, we thank you for your hand on our lives, each one of us, with the individual testimony of how you broke into our lives and turned our darkness into light, how you turned our mourning into gladness and dancing. Lord, how you turned each one of us from evil to your goodness.
We've been in a series these last few weeks in the book of Mark, Mark is the first book that was written that details Jesus' life. And we're in Mark chapter 2 this morning. I'm going to read that. The words are going to be on the screen, but if you've got a Bible, that's also fantastic. We're going to be looking at Mark chapter 2. And it begins and says, "And when he returned to Capernaum after some days, it was reported that he was at home, and many were gathered together, so that there was no more room, not even at the door. And he was preaching the word to them. And they came, bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. And when they could not get near the house because of the crowd, they removed the roof from above him. And when they had made an opening, they let down the bed on which the paralytic lay. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, 'Son, your sins are forgiven.' Now some of the scribes were sitting there, questioning in their hearts, 'Why does this man speak like that? He is blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?' And immediately Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they thus questioned within themselves, said to them, 'Why do you question these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, "Your sins are forgiven," or to say, "Rise, take up your bed and walk"? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, rise, pick up your bed and go home." And he rose and immediately picked up his bed and went out before them all, so that they were all amazed and glorifying God, saying, "We never saw anything like this."
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Excellent. I don't know if you know, guys, there's an app you can get on your phone called What Three Words. And what it does is it's taken the whole earth and split up 3 meter by 3 meter sections and given them three words to signify that particular area. So the place that I'm standing in right now is called Blackouts, Trails, Pounds. It's three words that describe this very spot where I'm sitting. Tom at the back over there is probably lifeboats, kitchens, offices. And where the kids' work is back there, if anyone wants to find them at the end, the kids' work is Workbook Sudden Spinners. There's three words that describe every 3 meter square on earth. And I was thinking about that, and if you were going to pick three words to describe Christianity, to describe what makes Christianity different to other religions, I don't know what you'd pick, and there's lots of good ideas, but I want to suggest to you that three words, forgiveness of sins, is part of what makes Christianity different to every other religion. Other religions have a concept of forgiveness of sins, but Christianity is centralized on the forgiveness of sins that we receive that comes through Jesus. Similarly, if you were to try and think of a Bible verse that sums up all of Christianity, what makes Christianity unique and different, I think verse 10 of this passage could well do that. And in verse 10 of this passage, Jesus says that you might know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. He has authority on earth to forgive sins. That's the main thing we're going to look at today. We're going to look at forgiveness of sins. And we're going to do this by doing these five steps. So it's a one-point sermon, really, but there are 5 points. And within them, there's actually 15 points. So it's a 15-point sermon masquerading as a 5-point sermon, which is really just a one-point sermon that we can have forgiveness of sins. And particularly this phrase I was struck by, that Jesus says that you might know that he has authority to forgive sins. I thought that phrase really popped out to me, that you might know. Jesus wants you to know that he has authority to forgive sins. It's something he wanted that crowd to know in the ancient world. It's something he wants us to know today, that he has authority on earth to forgive sins. And I was thinking about this, forgiveness of sins. It's quite an interesting phrase, because if you've been around church for a little while, you've probably heard that forgiveness is something that's central to Christianity. And it can sound almost elementary, you know, like we've done forgiveness, let's get on to the serious stuff. But I think when it's when you see your need for forgiveness that actually its beauty and its glory becomes all the more bright. So I was thinking about this. Some of you might know that in 2 weeks I'm doing a 10K run in Chesterfield. And so as part of that, you have to go into preparation and training. I don't know if any of you have done a 10K run before. You want to put your hand up, 10K. Anyone done a half marathon? Anyone done a whole marathon? Very interesting. Excellent. I have a theory, by the way. Yeah, well, I have a theory that the 100 metres is actually harder than a marathon. It's all about intensity, isn't it? You've got to run as hard as you can for 100 metres, where a marathon, you're pacing yourself. But the point I want to make is, a glass of water on its own today isn't that appealing. When you go to a coffee shop and you ask for a glass of water, people almost, what's wrong with you? Well, you can't even go to a coffee shop and ask for a cup of coffee, can you? You need to ask for a latte or a cappuccino, flat white. You can't even ask for tea. They want to know what type of tea you want. We live in a world where something like a glass of water can feel fairly redundant. But after you've been out running for 10 kilometres or half a marathon or a marathon, suddenly a glass of water, when you realise your need for it, feels wonderful. It feels amazing. It's exactly the thing that you need. And that's the same with forgiveness. When we realise our need for forgiveness, when we realise that it's a serious issue in our lives, that we need forgiveness from Jesus, when we realise that, it changes everything. And this is what happens in the Bible. It talks about forgiveness a lot. One of the most famous verses about forgiveness, John the Apostle writes and says, if we say we have no sin in our lives, we deceive ourselves and the truth isn't in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And ultimately, that's what we see of Jesus on the cross. What we see of Jesus on the cross isn't just a demonstration of forgiveness. We see it's the very way that God forgives people. And so in a book called Colossians in the Bible, there's a verse that says, we were once dead in our trespasses and sins, but God made us alive with Jesus. That's the reality, that before we knew Jesus, we weren't just bad people or good people. We weren't just moral or immoral. We were dead in our trespasses and sin. There was nothing that we could do to help ourselves, but God did a miracle where he took us from being dead in our trespasses and sin to being alive in Jesus. And it says how he did that is he forgave us our sins. And then it talks us through how he forgave us our sins. It says he took the charge of legal indebtedness that stood against us along with its legal requirements, and he nailed it to the cross. And what Paul does there is he paints a picture of our sins on like a rap sheet or a CV, every single wrong thing that we've ever done listed. And it's a rap sheet that stands against us to accuse us. And on the cross, what Jesus did is he took that rap sheet in his hand. And when the nails were driven through his hands, at the same time, the nails were driven through that list of sins and its consequences that stood against us. And so when Jesus on the cross paid that price, he made forgiveness possible. And so forgiveness, it is essential to the Christian faith. And the cross, it doesn't just show that God is forgiving, which is true. It shows us the means and the method through which he forgives us. So I've got a quote here from a guy called Martin Lloyd-Jones, and it says this. I think it's on the screen as well. It says, the cross does not merely tell us that God forgives. It tells us that it's God's way of making forgiveness possible. It is the way in which we understand how God forgives. And I will go further, he says. How can God forgive and remain God? That is the question. The cross is the vindication of God. The cross is the vindication of the character of God that not only shows the love of God more gloriously than anything else, it shows his righteousness, his justice, his holiness, and all the glory of his other attributes as well. They are all seen shining together there. If you do not see them all, you have not seen the cross. And his point there is that if you want to understand forgiveness, you have to look at the cross. And that's the central point of Christianity. That's where we see all of God's attributes, all of God's character, all of his glory being permeated into the world. And we, as human beings, we have a choice to make about whether we come to Jesus in faith and trust him for forgiveness, or we rely on ourselves. And Jesus tells a story about this. It's a really famous story in the church, and it's called the parable of the prodigal son. Maybe you've heard this story. And the story goes that there's a son who asks his father to go away and give him his money his inheritance so he can run away to another land. And he squanders all of his money on wild living and on prostitutes. And then he decides to come back to the father. And amazingly, the father forgives him and restores him into the family. And it's an amazing story of forgiveness. I've got another quote from Tim Keller here that really powerfully sums up this moment of forgiveness. I think it's on the screen again. It says, God's love and forgiveness can pardon and restore any and every kind of sin and wrongdoing. It doesn't matter who you are or what you've done. The younger brother knew that in his father's house there was food to spare, but he also discovered that there was grace to spare. There is no sin that the father's love cannot pardon and cover. There is no sin that is a match for his grace. The amazing thing about that story of the prodigal son is it shows the father's forgiveness, that there isn't any sin in the world that he won't forgive and atone when we come in faith to Jesus on the cross. But what Tim Keller also points out is that story that we call the parable of the prodigal son actually has two sons in the story. And he says both sons are equally lost. We have a younger brother who's lost in rebellion and wild living, and we have the older brother who's lost in self-righteousness and religion. And interestingly, at the end of the story, it's the younger brother who's characterized his life by prostitutes and wild living, who's inside the banquet, enjoying the father's fellowship. And it's the older brother who's outside and the father's beckoning in. And he points out in Luke 15, Tim Keller, that at the beginning of this parable, Jesus is speaking to two groups of people. He's speaking to tax collectors and sinners, and he's speaking to Pharisees. It's two groups of people, one that's lost far away and one that's lost close at home. And then he tells two more parables, one about a sheep that's lost far away and another about a coin that's lost close at home. And then he tells this story of two sons, a son that's lost far away and a son that's lost close at home. And the remarkable thing about the older brother is that he is lost, not because of the good things or bad things that he's done, but in spite of them. He's a man who's lived a righteous life in his own eyes. He's tried really hard. He's done everything that he feels like he's been commanded. He's done everything right in his own eyes. And he's still, at the end of the story, alienated from the Father because he won't come to the Father in faith, trusting for forgiveness of his sins. And the reality is, there are many people in our world who are like the younger brother, who get things wrong and make mistakes. But there are a lot of people whose main barrier in coming to Jesus is pride and religion and self-righteousness. There's a tendency in the human heart to think that we can make it and we can do it on our own, that we're good enough to sort it out on our own, not realizing that the center of Christianity is a cross, which shows the level and the depth of our sin, but the level and the depth that Jesus was willing to go to rescue us from our sin and bring us back into fellowship with the Father. I wanted to kind of think about a picture of how forgiveness works in someone's life. And I think the best picture that I've ever heard of it is in a C.S. Lewis book. If you've ever heard of C.S. Lewis, he wrote a series of books called The Chronicles of Narnia. And one of the characters in it is called Aslan, who's a picture after Jesus. And in one of his books called The Voyage of the Dawn Treader, there's a young guy called Eustace in the book. And he's not a very nice little boy. He's quite rude, he's quite aggressive, he's quite abrasive, he's quite hurtful, but he's also been really hurt by others. And he goes on this voyage of the Dawn Treader, it's a boat. And one day he finds a little island, and goes into the island and finds a little cave. And in that cave is a huge hoard of treasure, gold and diamonds and pieces of eight, everything you could possibly imagine. And what he does when he gets there is he starts to think, oh, now I'm rich. And he starts to think, now all those people who've ever wronged me, now I can wrong them back. All those people who've ever been mean to me, I can be mean back. All those people who've ever said nasty things to me, now it's my turn to pay them back for what they've done. And he fell asleep in the story, having those thoughts in his mind, not realizing that he was falling asleep inside a dragon's cave. It's a children's story, so you have to go with it. But because he fell asleep in the dragon's cave with dragonish thoughts, he woke up and he himself had become a dragon. And his callousness and his hardness and his bitterness had completely consumed him. and he couldn't escape, he couldn't get out, there was nothing he could do to help himself. And then one day, Aslan, the great lion, the lion that points to Jesus ultimately, turns up and says, if you want to be made well, if you want to be healed, if you want to be forgiven and set free, you need to come with me. And he takes him down to a pool of water and he says to him, you need to undress and get in the pool. And Eustace realizes what he means is he wants him to take off the dragon skin and get in the pool. So what he starts to do is he starts to claw and gnaw at the dragon skin, trying to pull off this callous dragon skin that's surrounding him. And eventually he does. And when he pulls off the dragon skin, he realizes that underneath is another layer of dragon skin. And so he pulls and gnaws at that again, trying to rip it off. And again, once he pulls that one off, he realizes that underneath is another layer of dragon skin. And as often as he tries, all he ever gets is more callousness, more brokenness, more bitterness, more dragon skin. And then in essence in the story, Aslan says to him, if you want it to happen, you need to let me take the dragon skin off. And then I've got a quote from the book here. I thought this was really powerful, an amazing picture of forgiveness. It says this, I was afraid of his claws, I can tell you, but I was pretty nearly desperate now. So the very first tear he made went so deep that I thought it had gone right into my heart. And when he began pulling the skin off, it hurt worse than anything I have ever felt. And then he goes on and says, well, he peeled the beastly stuff right off, just as I thought I'd done myself before the other three times, only they hadn't hurt. And there it was, lying in the grass, only ever so much thicker and darker and more knobbly looking than the others had been. And he threw me in the pool. It smarted like anything, but only for a moment. And then I saw I had become a boy again. And this picture in a children's book points to the reality of what forgiveness looks like. We can be so tempted, just like Eustace, to try and sort our problems externally through external implications and religious practices imposed on us, hoping that somehow that'll transform us on the inside out. But what we need is for Jesus to reach into our heart and tear away the callousness and the bitterness and the difficulties. And that's what forgiveness looks like, to see in our own lives all of those things taken away, a heart surgery and a transformation to take place that Jesus can come and do. That's the main thing we're looking at today. Our ultimate reality is that Jesus has authority to do that in your life. He has authority to forgive sins, to bring about transformation, to change you from the inside out. That's what he has authority to do that. And he wants you to know today that he has authority to forgive you your sins. That's the first thing. The second thing I want to look at today is two surprising misdirections. I spent a lot longer on that than I thought I would. I need to speed up. Two surprising misdirections. There are things in this passage that Jesus says, but he means something quite different. He says things, but means something quite different. I don't know if you've ever come across anyone who, like that, who says one thing, but means something quite different. I've got this slide behind me. Thank you, Chris. It's a little table, and it says in one column what British people say, in the middle column what they mean, and on the next column what other people understand. This has been written by an American guy who's married to an English woman, I think. So maybe this follows along with you. Let's see. So British people say, "I hear what you say." Someone from another culture might hear that and say, "Oh, he accepts my point of view, we're getting on." But what the British people mean is, I disagree, and I don't want to talk any further about this. The next one is, with the greatest respect. and people hear, oh, he's really listening and understanding what British people mean is, you're an idiot. I'll just do one more. The next one's, that was a British proposal I own. Quite good. And what people hear is that was quite good. And what British people mean was, it was a bit disappointing. The point I want to make here is, maybe this is a cultural thing, but we can all kind of say one thing and mean something else in a negative way, in a positive way. And this is what I want to say happens in this story. Jesus says one thing, but means something even more deep, even more true. And we see that in the interactions that the Pharisees have with Jesus at the end, and I only caught that when I read it. Jesus says to this man, I have authority to forgive you, and to prove that, I'm going to heal your paralysis so you can walk again. And then, do you remember what the Pharisees think? They think, that's blasphemy, because only God can forgive sins. And what they've done there is they've rightly understood what Jesus meant by what he said. Because he said, I forgive you your sins. And what he meant was a claim to be God himself. The Pharisees get that. They get what he says and they get what he means. And that's a fairly big claim. It's a fairly massive claim. Jesus claims to be God in the flesh, the one who is able to forgive sins. And interestingly, all the way through the Old Testament, God claims that when someone sins, it's actually a sin against him. And so Jesus here comes to this man and claims that he can forgive him. And in forgiving him, what he's claiming is that every sin, every wrong thing this man has ever done has actually been a sin against him. Think about this is how it works. If I was to go out for dinner with Dave and with Barry, and Dave was to punch Barry for a good reason, I couldn't then turn to Dave and say, Dave, I forgive you for that, because I'm not the offended party. But in the Old Testament, God claims that every time someone sins, he's the ultimate offended party. Do you remember that incident with David and Bathsheba in the Old Testament? David sleeps with Bathsheba, gets her pregnant, and then plots to kill her husband, and then writes a psalm and says, in all of that, against God and God only have I sinned and done what's evil in his sight. And so Jesus in this moment is claiming that every wrong thing that this man and you've ever done is actually ultimately a sin against him. It's something that has offended him, and so he has authority to forgive. It's a surprising misdirection. It's what makes this passage so interesting. A second one happens when the paralyzed man comes to Jesus, and Jesus looks at him and says, I forgive you your sins. And if that was me at that point, I might look to Jesus and say, that's lovely, Jesus, but I'm actually, what I'm here for is to be able to walk again. I've got a more pressing concern, Jesus, than you think I do. And Jesus at that point would say, no, you don't. And maybe you've come to church this morning with concerns. Jesus cares about those concerns, they're serious to him. Maybe they're concerns about finances or health or the future or politics, whatever they are. Jesus cares about them and he's interested in them, but they're not his ultimate concern. His ultimate concern is that you're right with the Father, that your life is right with the Father. And how that happens is that you receive forgiveness from him by coming to him on the cross with faith that he is able to forgive. He wants you to know that he has authority to forgive you your sins today. Third point, three wonderful things we see about forgiveness. I might be really quick on this one. Three wonderful things we see about forgiveness. We see that first, forgiveness is necessary. Forgiveness is necessary in your life. You need to be forgiven by Jesus. I want to be honest with you. If you don't come to Jesus for forgiveness, the Bible says really clearly that that means that you are separated from the Father and you will spend eternity separated from the Father in a terrible place called hell. It's not an easy subject. It's a hard subject. It's a terrifying subject. But it's the reality. Forgiveness of your sins, your personal sins, is necessary. It's needed. Second, it's costly. Fortunately, it's not costly to you, but it's incredibly costly to Jesus. Ultimately, it cost him his life on the cross. And thirdly, we see that forgiveness here leads to hostility. And interestingly, in verse 12, what you see for the first time in the Gospel of Mark is opposition to what Jesus is doing. Opposition to his message. Opposition to forgiveness. I read one book this week and the author said that this act of forgiveness was the first step that Jesus took to the ultimate step of forgiveness on the cross. And this healing of this paralyzed man was the first step that he took towards himself being paralyzed on a cross. And this healing of a man's legs and feet was the first step that he took towards his feet being pierced by nails on a cross. The fourth thing we see is four faithful friends. Four faithful friends. We're here today to celebrate Faithful's dedication, and we're thankful for God's faithfulness, but we also see here friends who are faithful. They are literally full of faith. They have faith in Jesus that he's able to do what they think he's able to do. But interestingly, they have only a partial knowledge of Jesus, don't they? They've heard that he's a miracle worker, and they have a thought that he would be able to help their friends with a physical situation that he's facing. And they're right. I read this week. It says, these four friends' faith is persevering, creative, confident, resourceful, and determined. They have a faith that's persevering, creative, confident, resourceful, and determined in the fact that their friend has a physical situation that they believe Jesus is able to help with in their right. And the message of this story is that there is a great miracle that Jesus is able to do. The forgiveness of healing is one level, but he wants you to point beyond that to see that he's able to forgive you your sins. And if you're a Christian here today, you're in a very different position to these four faithful friends, because you know firsthand that Jesus not only has authority to forgive sins, but you can experience it in your life. And this is the point I want to make. These four friends, they are persevering, creative, confident, resourceful, and determined in their faith to bring their friend to Jesus, who they believe is able to help him in a physical situation that they probably have very little first-hand experience of. How much more then should we who have experienced this greater reality, this greater miracle, be creative, resourceful, determined in bringing people to experience this ultimate reality of forgiveness of sins in their lives? Fifth point, I'm very nearly done. Five life applications. We've got here some pictures of what people call spite houses. I don't know if you've ever come across a spite house. What it is, in essence, is a house that exists simply to spite another person. So this is a really famous one. That's Macy's in New York. And that house there, you can probably see it cut out. They refused to sell part of that house to Macy's. And so they kept the house there simply to spite Macy's from building this up. Simply as a reminder, a daily reminder, that they had done something wrong and they wanted everyone to know that they'd done something wrong. Have you got the next one? There's a few of them. You get the picture. There you go. That house was built. Situation here. There were two brothers. One brother got the house and the other brother got a plot of land but felt he'd been wrongly treated. So what he decided to do was to build a house on that plot of land simply to spite his brother and to block the sun from coming in. We've got another one, you get the idea of this probably. That's another house built there simply to spite the neighbour on the left and to block the sun from going in. These things are called spite houses and they exist simply as a reminder that that person has done something wrong. And have you got the 5 points, Chris? That would be brilliant. And this is what I want to make. The Bible makes it really clear that when we've received forgiveness from Jesus, what that means is that an impact happens in our lives where that leads us to being forgiving. So first, forgiving people forgive. If you've been forgiven by Jesus, there's a call in your life to be forgiving to others. Second, let forgiveness be your operating system. If you have a computer, probably you do, you know that the operating system on there, everything functions and runs through it. And Martin Luther, a guy who lived a few hundred years ago, wasn't talking about computers, but he said, it's really easy if you're a Christian to default into the settings that the world runs on, of bitterness and anger and frustration. But he says we need to let the forgiveness of Jesus be the thing that impacts everything that we do. Third thing, unforgiveness is serious. If you're a Christian and there is unforgiveness towards a person or a situation in your life, that is really, really serious. I just want to encourage you to deal with it. Deal with it today. It's really serious if you harbour unforgiveness in your life. They're not the same as reconciliation, by the way. There might be consequences for things that happen, but forgiveness can happen in your heart. You can bring about forgiveness in your heart today. Fourth thing, don't stop rejoicing in the forgiveness that Jesus brings into your life. And the fifth thing, an encouragement to you, those four faithful friends brought their friend to Jesus. How much more can you bring people to know a real sense of forgiveness in their lives? I've got one last quote to finish, and then we're going to celebrate with Anilo and Valentina as we dedicate Faithful. This quote is quite long, but it will be quick. It says, Christ does not get flustered and frustrated when we come to him for fresh forgiveness, for renewed pardon with distress and need and emptiness. don't know if you caught that. If you come to Jesus today for forgiveness, whether it's for the first time or a thousandth time, he doesn't get flustered or frustrated with you. He wants to forgive. That's the whole point, it says. He went down into the horror of death and plunged out through the other side in order to provide a limitless supply of mercy and grace to his people. There's a limitless supply of mercy and grace for you today. But there's a deeper point. Jesus doesn't want us to draw on his grace and mercy only because it vindicates his atoning work. He doesn't want you to come to receive forgiveness today just because it makes him feel better about the things that he's done. He wants us to draw on his grace and mercy because it's who he is. He drew near to us in the incarnation so that his joy and ours could rise and fall together. His in giving mercy and ours in receiving it. Christ gets more joy and comfort than we do when we come to him for help and mercy. In the same way that a loving husband gets more relief and comfort in his wife's healing than in his own, Christ brings it into himself more comfort than it procures to them when he sees our sins being placed under his own blood. The reality of what's being said there is when you come afresh for forgiveness, whether for the first or the thousandth time, Jesus isn't angry, he isn't bitter, he isn't frustrated, he's not looking into himself to hope that you would come to forgiveness to make himself feel better. Forgiveness and grace and mercy is who Jesus is, it's his character, it's his nature, and it's available for you today. Shall we pray? Father, we just thank you that today forgiveness is available. We thank you that 2,000 years ago, Jesus wanted that crowd to know that he had authority to forgive sins. And I pray that that knowledge would be made manifest in this room, that you would help us to know that you have authority on earth to forgive sins, and particularly to forgive our sins. And so we just take this opportunity to confess to you the sins that have plagued us today, this week, this month. Father, we ask for your forgiveness afresh. And Jesus, we pray that you would flood us afresh with your grace and your mercy and your peace. We come to you in faith. We come to the cross again. And we thank you that there is an effective provision for our forgiveness when we come to the cross. Amen. We've got a wonderful opportunity to celebrate with Onilo and Valentina the life and the birth of Faithful. I'm just going to ask Mary to pray for us in a minute. How it's going to work, we've got a song, a music video song that we're going to play. And then after that, what we're going to do is we're going to essentially invite Onilo and Valentina up to share very briefly, to pray. And then friends can come and pray. Church family can come and pray. We'll all come and pray, lay hands on them together, and then me and myself and Mary will close up. Are you willing to pray for us, Mary? Thank you.
Father, I thank you for the word that Tom brought to us this morning. Thank you for your forgiveness. Father, help us to forgive as well. And I thank you for the life of faith, and I thank you that we get to celebrate her now.
We'll just say dance with the song from the door. Just say dance.
Thank you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This morning we are very grateful to stand before you and then to stand before our Maker and our God and to bring a faithful to Him and dedicate her to Him. Words cannot express our joy. And if you come from a traditional African society like us, I've been married for 9 years now, and you know, for that 9 years, we've had lots of experiences, we've gone through several IVF and lots of stuff. And you know, it's if you come from our society, you know it's a serious issue for you to be married and not have kids. But we've been praying when we came around. You know, Tom and Sarah joining us to pray, and there were one or two people, and Paul also joining us, and you know, and all that. And somehow God just surprised us and answered our prayers, and so we are grateful to Him. And we just want to bring her back to Him and say, Lord, we present her back to you. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for faithful. We appreciate you for the gift of this child. You say houses and riches are inheritance from the Father. A prudent wife he brings from the Lord. And Lord, through her, you say children are gift of the Lord. The fruit of the womb is your reward. Happy are those whose quiver are full of them, for they shall contend with their enemies at the gate. Father, we thank you for this one because she will be an instrument in your hand in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Lord, we ask for your blessings to rest upon her from the crown of her head to the sole of her feet. Lord, we ask that you cause her to be a voice in our generation. She will not be stopped in the name of Jesus. Lord, your hand will be mighty upon her life. You will set her apart. What clique other children will not clique her? You will separate her. And I ask that your seal of ownership will rest on her. Lord, that wherever she go, Lord, men will favor her. People will struggle to help her. Lord, she will be a representative of your faithfulness and of your goodness. That when people see her, they will be reminded of you. Thank you, Holy Father, for who you are. We declare that she's blessed. We declare that she's kept. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Any friends just want to come? Welcome to lay hands and pray for the family.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah, when we were in school, they used to call Bernard and myself twin brothers because we were that close. And I remember when Val and Ben were about to get married, if they had any issues they contended with, and she came to me and asked secretly, when I gave her an answer, she would just say, he's probably disgusted with me because our opinions will almost be the same about it. I know when they got married, I know everything they've gone through, and when this happened, all we could say is, this is just God. And sometimes for people who serve God very faithfully, I think God allows them to pass through some issues so that when other people see it, they can, you know that God can be faithful to the people who serve Him.
Amen.
And for them to have waited this long for this to happen, and they've done IVFs and it didn't work, and then just suddenly, there can't be any other way. You know, if people wanted to argue that there is no God, then this is more than enough evidence to show that there is God. And I'm so happy for them. And I know that this baby is a blessing. She will do great things. She is great indeed. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Father, we thank you. We bless you. We appreciate you. Because you've shown us what it means to be a father. You give good gifts unto your children. You've shown that you know what we are going through. You see what we are going through. And you always prove your word that at the right time you make all things beautiful. I thank you for making the life of my friend and his wife
beautiful at this time in the name of Jesus. We thank you for this child that you have given as a gift unto them and unto us in general. As faithful has come into this world, and if called are faithful, as evidence of your faithfulness in their life, so shall it continually be in the name of Jesus. They shall from time to time witness you as a faithful God in Jesus' name. And I pray for the child, O God, because you brought her into this world specially for a special purpose. Your hands will be mighty upon her, and she'll fulfill every purpose for which you brought her in the mighty name of Jesus. I prophesy unto your life that the light of God shall always be upon you. Upon you shall rest the Spirit of the Most High God. And because that Spirit has got attributes, very special ones, one of which is joy, your life will be filled with joy in the name of Jesus. Love shall fill your life in the name of Jesus. You shall be excellent, and you shall be exceeding among your peers in the mighty name of Jesus. And for your family and the community where you find yourself, you will always be a blessing, O God. You will be a sign and the evidence that God is and dwells among his people in the mighty name of Jesus. I decree for your life that the spirits that rule the children of the world will not be upon you, because in you already dwell the Spirit of the Most High God in the name of Jesus. And I pray for the parents that every wisdom, every knowledge, and every grace that is required to bring you up in the way of the Lord, in the way that when you grow up, you would come to love the Lord even more than they did, they will receive that grace in multiple folds in the name of Jesus. Amen. And to the community of the children of God whom you are going to dwell with, they have a role to play in your life as well. And I pray that all the grace that they need to do that, they will receive in the mighty name of Jesus. We receive you with great joy. And we return all thanks to God the Father, to God the Son, and to God the Holy Spirit. Amen. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Guys, this is a real family moment, so if you feel willing to come and just put a hand out or come closer, lay hands on these guys, it's a great opportunity. We're just going to have two or three people pray really quickly over them, and then we're going to dedicate faithful to the Lord. But don't be shy and all that kind of stuff. Come on board and lay hands on them and let's bless them together.
Father, I thank you for the way that you have shown yourself faithful to Manilo and Valentina. Father, I thank you and I praise you that you will show yourself faithful to faithful, and she will testify to your faithfulness. Bless her, Lord Jesus. Faithful, God works all things, the good and the bad, for the good of those who love him. And he loves you. He gave his son to die for you. He gave his son to give you his righteousness. He loves you, so you can love him, and I encourage you to seek his face, and he will work all things for your good, and he will show himself faithful.
Amen.
Family. I thank you so much for bringing them to us. I thank you so much for a witness, what a witness they are to us, and what joy they have brought us, Lord. And I just pray, Lord, that you will pour out your joy and your peace and your provision on this family, and that each day they will experience more of you. They'll understand more of you. They'll be transformed more by your by your grace and your goodness.
Father, we thank you for Chidwende and Milo. Thank you for their faith in you, for their faith has produced faith. Father, I thank you that you have blessed them with this child. Thank you for her health. And Father, we ask that you would protect her all the days of her life, and that you would give wisdom to her parents. They would have faith in you every day of their lives, Father. And that you would give them the strength they need to be great parents, Father. Thank you for your provision in that area.
Yeah, Father, we just thank you so much for your grace and your mercy. We just thank you so much for this wonderful family. We thank you that the light of Jesus shines through them so clearly and so evidently. And Father, we pray your blessing and your grace, your power, your mercy, your faithfulness to be shown to Anilo and Valentina and to Faithful. I just thank you that you are faithful through the ages, you're faithful through generations. Your faithfulness endures. The steadfast love of the Lord, it never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. And Jesus, we just now lift this family before you. We pray for grace as parents. We pray for strength as parents. We pray that you would give them a heart and a will and a desire to serve you in fresh ways and to bring faithful up in the faith. Father, we pray for them. We commit ourselves as a body of believers to help and support and encourage. We thank you for them and we give them your grace. And Father, now we hold Faithful before you and we dedicate her. We dedicate her life to you. We pray, Jesus, that you would call her and claim her and name her as your own. Amen. We pray that you would show your grace and your glory through her life. And Jesus, we just take this opportunity. We lift together as a family of faith. We lift Faithful to you and we say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. We pray that she is yours. We pray that she would live for you. We pray that she would receive forgiveness and put her faith and her trust and her confidence in the only name that is able to save, the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
As we dedicate Faithful to the Lord, I'm just going to bring her around so anyone who wants to see it can see it. Maybe we can just give Faithful as she comes around for her tour of the church. We can give her a round of applause as we dedicate to the Lord. Just to explain what's going to happen next, a bit unusual, a bit different than usual. We're not going to have refreshments straight after the service. We're going to go into kind of a mad, kind of packed down sort out here, and we're going to head to New Street, which is our other building in town. We're going to have some food and some cake. Absolutely everybody's welcome. It'll be brilliant to see you there. We've not got refreshments as usual, so we're really sorry about that. But if you're able to come down for 5 minutes or for an hour, there'll be some great stuff happening down at New Street. Just to say that Park Road is closed. That road near Costa and Pizza Hut. So you have to go around the back of the park. If you've got any problems, if that makes no sense to you, that series of statements, do come and chat to me or Rachel or Mary or Adrian, who's singing this morning. We'll happily give you better directions than that. Otherwise, should we praise the Lord? Thank you.
it seems appropriate that we sing the Emmaus song again to say thank you.
Yes.
Stack chairs, but otherwise see you later or see you next week and have a blessed week.